today.
Yo, what's up, my dogs? Today we're gonna hit you with the hottest show yet.
What is this?
I'm your co-host. Every good award show needs an energetic co-host.
No, this wasn't part of the deal. Fine. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first annual Andrew Talking About Musical episodes framed as an award show because top tens are overdone. Little on the nose.
With me.
The musical episode, a random episode out of the series that, for no particular reason, characters burst into song and occasionally dance, like that of a musical. Sometimes it's a specific episode full of musical songs, and sometimes it's a series where every episode has at least one song, and today we're talking about the former. I wanted to watch musical episodes as a whole, so I made the decision to watch them all and then rank them accordingly. Ironically enough, when I went to go check the list of musical episodes, most of them are from shows that not only have I seen before, but shows I actually really like. I'd already seen most of them. You see, musicals are inherently nerdy and uncool. That's why you get the theater kid trope. And it just so happens that most musical episodes are from shows that I really like. That really says more about me than it does the show. This is already going to be very long, so instead of talking about all of them, I decided to talk about the ones of the shows I've watched or shows I already like. That would be the same category. Since there are already a lot of episodes like that, and I would rather put bamboo shoots under my toenails than ever watch How I Met Your Mother.
Cute. Nothing suits me like a Seuss.
Oh, but you could just watch one episode. No, you can't. If you want to grasp the full intricacy of the musical episode, you need to watch the series at least up until that point, because otherwise all you know is that musical episode, and it stands out from the rest of the series. I don't know why I'm using my arm as an example. I've been doing this for a long time, but as it turns out, most of these musical episodes doubled as Christmas episodes, so I saved it for now. Gave me a lot of time to think about it, which is never a good thing. Happy holidays. First, we have to set some ground rules about what counts as a musical episode. Most shows can't be as long as musicals because musicals are long as dicks. So let's just say a minimum of 3 songs in an episode. So that excludes The Ghost of Molly Magee, Animaniacs, and I really wanted to put that in this video, but it doesn't count, so seeing it now. It also needs to be an average length episode for it to count. So some shows are 11 minutes long, their episodes, and like the musical episodes are 22 minutes, but 22 minutes is already standard television length, so that's not like absurdly long. I'll allow that. What I won't allow is movies. It's commonplace for cartoons mainly to adapt the musical style when they're doing a theatrical film, but we're not talking about that today. Hey, you forgot Wubsy's Big Movie. Did you watch Wubsy's Big Movie? Of course I watched Wubsy's, but I'm a professional. It doesn't count because it's a musical movie. I also watched this. Unfortunately, this is the last you're gonna see of this today, so get a good look. And now that I've set a strict set of rules now, I would like to give honorable mentions to the stuff that breaks all those rules. Honorable mentions to obviously The Ghost of Molly Magee, Animaniacs, and Total Drama. All of these are good shows or good seasons of shows with songs that I unironically listen to a lot. Specifically the Zit song and I'm Gonna Make It. God, I love Total Drama.
But that's not what we're here to talk about.
I'm just gonna try to ignore him. Also, honorable mentions to Fairly Odd Parents School's Out and South Park Bigger, Longer, and Uncut. Both of these I listen to all the time. The reason people don't ask me for music recommendations. But they're both movies, so I couldn't count them. Maybe someday I'll talk about them in length. I'm setting up a lot of seeds for stuff I'm gonna do. I gotta stop with these side tangents.
But now it's time for
School's Out stands out in particular because Fairly Odd Parents isn't really known for good animation, so seeing the musical sequence is done really well, it makes it good. Also, most of the songs are really good and there's a ton of them in it.
We need to move on.
Also, Fairy Idol. I don't like that one as much, but Norm MacDonald's in it and I love his character and I love him. He's great on the show. I love him.
Okay, that's enough.
South Park Bigger, Longer, and Uncut was so good that it got snubbed at the Tonys and then Matt Stone and Trey Parker made the Book of Mormon out of spite. That rocks. Fine. Can I just do one final honorable mention?
We haven't even started the actual video yet.
Yeah, but this is important.
Fine, I'll give you
1 minute and 12 seconds.
Awesome. When I first had this idea a couple months back, the original idea was to rank all the musical episodes by how good of episodes they were. It's one thing to be an episode with good songs, but which of these episodes are actually good episodes, which is the best episode? Pretty much this entire ceremony was built around what I thought was the best musical episode, in my opinion, The Devil's Hands or Idle Playthings from Futurama.
Never! A deal's a deal, even with a dirty dealer.
Very well, then I'll take what I want from Leela.
So I rewatched it, like I did with all these episodes, I also rewatched the series up until that point, and it's not a musical episode. I remembered it being one because the ending is made up of very long opera, which could be argued as close enough, but as far as the episode goes, it's only one long song, and it only appears at the end. Out of all the episodes and honorable mentions that I counted, this one is the best one. Not just best musical episode, which it isn't, but best episode. That's because it was originally intended to be the finale of the series, but because of popular demand and DVD sales, the show got brought back. Watch the Adult Swim video. It's funny, it's beautiful, it's touching. If I counted episodes with one song, then this would win. Well, actually, it'd be a close race with this and The View from Halfway Down, but maybe it would still win. All right, honorable mentions over. We can start the ceremony now.
You hear that, kids at home?
Don't direct this at children.
Be sure to hop on your phone with your parents' permission and vote for who you think will win the next award.
There's a lot of contention about what episode is actually the first musical episode. A lot of people think it's Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and that's not technically true. While that episode is possibly the first to have multiple different songs that the characters spontaneously burst into, it isn't technically the first episode to revolve around songs, if you can even call them songs. I don't normally agree with whatever weird things they bring in to torment me, but they've got a point. I want you to vote in your head right now, what do you think is the first ever technical musical episode? Because I guarantee you're not gonna get it right. And the winner is technically the first show to do a musical episode while also being very bad. Award. Chris Pratt.
Hey, paisanos, it's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
With the Mario Brothers and Plumbing's a game.
I'm not happy about this either, but it's all on a technicality. The Super Mario Bros. Super Show is in this weird place where the only two Super Mario games out at the time were Mario the First and the game that wasn't even supposed to be Mario. So all the characters look weird, everyone acts strange, and really all they had to go off of was, oh, spaghetti and plumbing. This episode, Bad Rap, counts as a musical episode because all the dialogue is spoken as a rap, and I do mean spoken as a rap.
Plumber's log number 224, rap land isn't rapping anymore. Cooper took their king and the money too. We're here to figure out what to do.
The late 80s were a terrible time for rap, where everyone talked like Will Smith Disney rap. Even worse is that whoever worked on the show were already overworked and underpaid and had no idea what rap was. That's okay, new things are scary, I get it. Oh, rap is when you rhyme? Oh, so it's like poetry then. Yeah, we could probably do that. Can you blame them for not caring? This show is notorious for having so many goddamn issues. The animation portion, at least, is all music. However, the live action bits, yeah, I said live action bits, WWF wrestler Sergeant Slaughter stops by on secret government business. If you don't know anything about professional wrestling, I don't know what to tell you, man. He's an army guy who then became an insensitive Iraqi sympathizer when an actual war was going on. They always know how to capitalize on topics at the right time.
Well, R-Truth, he's much like a lot of America, obsessed with Pokemon Go. Make a tag to R-Truth! I think you found him!
Oh boy, here comes the second theme song. And yes, they played it twice. The entire episode is made up of this, for lack of a better term, bad rap. King Koopa brainwashed the scary youth by rapping terrible, and the only way to prevent conversion is to wear these headphones, except for when the episode forgets that part. Oops, someone forgot to crop that part out. See, this is what I'm talking about. Why did the background change mid-run? Everyone moves like they're running on a high-speed treadmill going the other direction. If I gave you a point-for-point plot synopsis, you would probably think this is like a 5-minute short. This goes on for 20 minutes.
I'll do it, Luigi. Give me a boost.
Can we speed this up a little bit? They solve the conflict by unplugging a big plug. I don't know what it means either. They play one backing track on loop and spew the worst rap lyrics you could ever hear.
In the end, Koopa's gone, and Rapland's got a brand new song.
This does not add up. We are going to beat you to death. And then they play the Mario Show theme song. Again, they ran out of music and played the theme song for the third time this episode, mind you. There are these two twin characters, and their only thing is that they're fat. That's all the other characters have to say about them. Why are they here?
Koopa, this time you're through.
One false move and we'll sit on you.
Talk about the pot calling the kettle black, Mario.
Wait, Mario, you forgot your spaghetti.
Oh shit, we need more filler. Cut back to the war crimes. What is happening? I'm just grasping at straws here now. Hey, listen to Koopa's voice.
Give me your money, Robland lady. Something's going on. Something shady.
Why he sound like that? Well, that was terrible. My only idea for that was to use the theme song as a throwaway joke, but it went too far, and that's 20 minutes of my life I'm never gonna get back.
Uh-oh, kids at home. Looks like I'm accidentally standing in the slime zone.
What are you doing? This is supposed to be a dignified award show. We'll be right back. Well, I have officially cleaned all the slime off of my very expensive suit, even though that just hit me in the temple, but it spreads around. It's time to announce the award for the best musical episode to be banned because of either communism or epilepsy. Did I read that right?
The city of Townsville's going down. Right on my head will be a brand new crown.
This one probably requires a bit of explanation. The season 5 episode of the Powerpuff Girls, the first one, See Me, Feel Me, Know Me, an episode that you cannot watch
anywhere.
It was on the official DVD and was on Netflix for a little bit, but if you look on Hulu now, the streaming service the Powerpuff Girls is currently on, it will not be there. I will not explain how I watched it, because everything I do is completely legal. There's a lot of rumors about why this episode got banned almost immediately. The two most popular ones being, this episode has communism, and epilepsy. And in all fairness, I should probably slow this footage down to not hurt anyone's eyes. I could see one of these being an option. You know what would make our musical episode look even cooler? If we flashed red and white on the screen really fast. Oh yeah. And the communism. The plot of this episode is that the Powerpuff Girls are tired of fighting crime and just want to be normal little girls. Weirdly enough, that's the same plot as the weird CW Powerpuff Girls reboot coming out.
That was weird.
A little man comes down on a red rose and promises to keep the people safe and get rid of all the villains if the girls give up their powers. Are you seeing where this might be going?
And with my magic mystic tricks, I'll turn Townsville into right.
If this guy sounds familiar to you, it's not because you know who he is, but because he was designed to sound familiar. They wanted Jack Black in this role, but he got way too popular at this time for them to get him. So instead they got... not Jack Black. I mean, he does a good job. I should say, actually, there are a lot of musicals I think I like because I listen to the soundtracks all the time, but then watch them and go, oh yeah, this isn't good. Oh man, Will Smith is really going hard in this song. Maybe I should watch the movie. What is this? This episode is one of those moments. I don't think there's a single song I don't like, but the episode is a little messy. It's a bold decision to have no dialogue that isn't sung whatsoever because most musical episodes are just normal episodes with a lot of songs thrown in. The problem with this is that everything is very confusing. It's a popular internet theory to claim that this episode tried to tackle communism and, but it's actually more of a cult. That being said, everyone here is happy. The gnome gets the attention he wants. The people seem happy and are safe. Nobody told them to wear those robes. They just like them as they're comfortable. And the girls are happy to be normal girls. At no point do any of the characters decide they are unhappy on their own. All that happens is that the professor shows up and tells the girl that the people
sacrificing their hopes and their dreams, all their individuality for freedom.
And like, kind of? I mean, they got the robes for themselves. I don't normally like American propaganda, but freedom beef goes kind of hard.
Do the people have to be freedom beef?
Although my favorite song is the one at the opening, because you could say what you want about the Powerpuff Girls themselves, but their villains were always so expressive. Also, it's weird to see Gang Green Guy singing for the first time, considering Something Something Gorillas. All of the villains in the show singing the opening song is such a dope idea, which makes it even weirder that they all just die horrible deaths in the first couple minutes. We never see the gnome guy really doing anything evil. He's just taking a bubble bath, and he only attacks the girls after they threaten him in the form of song. Oh yeah, and they also get their powers back. It's not really explained, aside from the throwaway line that they're fighting for freedom, so they never really lost their powers.
Take this flower, live in peace. Remember who changed your lives, it was not police.
Man, maybe this episode is kind of based.
We're not your guiding light, dear town, dear town.
You all have equal rights.
Oh shit, even Vampire Guy? Thanks, Powerpuff Girls. I thought the point of the episode was that they gave up all their rights for freedom, but now they're talking about balance, I guess.
Ooh, oh, don't you know that everybody knows the yin and yang's the master plan?
So your point is not that giving up your life to feel safe is bad, but that evil can't exist without good, and also vice versa, even though he didn't do anything. And then when they kill him in another
epilepsy moment,
they sing with all the villains about how they should all put their differences aside and all get along. That's not yin and yang. This is yin.
As I descend to the earth, and I view the universe above me, I realize that life evolves, revolves, and dissolves completely around the opposites. Therefore, I conclude that I cannot exist in my utopian mind.
Good news, they laid out their entire thesis with this guy's death. Bad news, it doesn't make any goddamn sense.
There's no sun without the moon. There's no fork without the spoon.
There's no silence without noise. There's no girls without the boys.
You know what? I don't think this episode represents anything. There's no way this episode got banned because of a communist illusion. I gotta check the Powerpuff Girls wiki. It says, the episode was pulled and banned in the United States from its time slot on February 27th, 2004 because Cartoon Network claimed that the metal beams in the destroyed buildings looked too much like crosses and that one of the hippies looked like Jesus. What? He's just like a generic hippie. So what, am I being placeboed by this then? The seizure-inducing strobe lights were just a coincidence? Anyways, I think we should move
on. Wow, here comes special guest Jack Black.
What's up, kids? It's me, hit star of year one, Jack Black.
That doesn't sound anything like Jack Black.
But nights at Freddy's, that's where I wanna be.
Alright, can we move on from Jack Black? I'm presenting the award for episode with the real actual Jack Black in it. Why do I bother saying anything?
After this line, there's gonna be a refrain. Watch me, hold me, sign my cast for me.
Finally, a good episode. Now, the episode itself is really funny, but it kind of feels like the musical aspect is more of like an elaborate bit, which to be fair, is very Clone High. There's an opening song, which is always nice to have, and then a disembodied voice sings the next 30-second song, and you think, oh boy, it's Tarzan all over again. But then Jack Black starts singing, and you think, oh, it's just gonna be him. And then the last 10 minutes go into
maximum overdrive.
I'll build it higher, I'm getting higher.
What most people don't actually really notice is that Clone High is a pretty musical series. Back in the day before MTV was the Ridiculousness Channel, but after it was, hey, let's watch music videos for 6 hours, it was filled with an even mixture of overdramatic teen dramas and music, kind of like the CW now. Where is that coming from? We're inside. So Clone High, I want to say it's a compromise between those two, but I mean, it's a pretty scathing parody of those teen dramas. Like, it has no love for them whatsoever. The music, however, is a different story. Either MTV mandated that they use songs or they gave them access to the huge music library, because honestly, Clone High wouldn't be Clone High without the early 2000s edge drama music. I love that garbage. Because of this, Clone High actually has access to musicians like Jack Black and people worse than Jack Black. This scary figure, the Pusher, has convinced the children of Clone High that you can get high off of raisins, and because it's Clone High, they all instantly believe him.
Solar babies, la uva loca, California's finest, all for you to smoke on.
I like your funny words, Magic Man.
I'm not an animator, yet, but I've heard time and time again that the best way to get into animating is to use a song you like. That's why you'll see a ton of animatics online set to musical songs or just regular songs with a completely different subject matter. Animation lends itself to music. Ever since, like, Fantasia, they've worked together to make cool-looking visuals. And because this episode is also about drug use, they stretch the animation to their limits and make the backgrounds trippy and cool, and magically, they didn't give anyone seizures. How did they do it? But yeah, this episode doesn't have the dated music every other episode has, so it should age better.
It is I, Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen.
Alright, I'm sure that was very funny at the time. Normally I like listening to the songs on their own the best, and it's not like the songs are bad, but the episode definitely looks better and is funnier than the actual song portions sound. That sentence did not make sense, I don't think. Maybe it'll get stuck in your head. You can't really lose when you cast Jack Black in your rock opera.
G'day, Gandhi. It is I, Daniel Feldspar, a stereotypically Australian dragon. I'm gonna eat you like a dingo eats his baby.
Did I mention this episode is really funny? Not just that, but along with the psychedelic visuals, they also sneak in a lot of subliminal messages for whatever reason. But I like it. Also, I don't know if this has ever been brought up before, but this episode features a lot of allusions to who the clones are. Clones of. Gandhi's psychedelic adventure leads him to the Mary-Kate and Ashley monster, who tells him to complete his journey, he should act more like the real Gandhi. You know, it just occurred to me that if someone hasn't seen this show, then this has just been very confusing, sorry. I know I've tried to sell you guys on stuff before, but just watch this episode. It's not like me telling you to get HBO Max for Moral Oral. It's on YouTube. That's where I watched it, because it's not on Paramount Plus. Do you hate money, Viacom?
This quest is too hard. What would the real Gandhi do?
Hey, Dragon, I'm thinking about going on a hunger strike, but I've never tried Vegemite.
Never tried Vegemite?
Abe meets the real Abraham Lincoln in his head, and they try to burn Joan of Arc, which I thought was funny. If you haven't seen the show, you're like, well, of course they're gonna rep, they're clones of the original guys, but this actually doesn't come up as often as you would think. What else is there to say? Great episode, okay music. If they do another one in the reboot, I hope the songs are spread out more.
I am now going to assault your mind with subliminal messages. Sorry you had to see that.
What a treat. Finally a good episode.
And in a shocking turn of events, you guys voted SpongeBob as the greatest show of all time with 90% of the votes. In second place, The Sopranos.
This is supposed to be a Christmas celebration. How is what you're doing related at all?
But you haven't talked about a single Christmas episode yet.
I'm building up to it.
Well, give them a sneak peek. Talk about the Phineas and Ferb Christmas special or something. No. Don't tell me you didn't put Phineas and Ferb Christmas special on the list.
That one doesn't count.
It doesn't count?
Yeah, you know what? Episode that always gets overlooked even though it's a better musical episode than the official musical episode. Alright, time to argue.
Because that gives you individuality.
Nice dude, but back to the matter at hand. So what do you say? Are you back in the band?
Well, maybe if I can find my old leather.
Dude, we're getting the band back together.
Roller Coaster the Musical is nowhere near as good as Dude, We're Getting the Band Back Together. Phineas and Ferb at its core is a very musical series. However, the pilot episode is super different from the series in a lot of ways. It shares more similarities with the original pitch than the actual final product. So to compensate for this, they remade the roller coaster episode, but this time as a musical episode. From the start, this new take on the episode was intended to be a musical. The best thing about the episode is all the musical references they cram in while DWGTBBT has none. I cannot believe I got that in one shot. I mean, you could argue this might be a reference to the telephone hour from Bye Bye Birdie, but personally, I think it might actually be referencing the hit film Stuck in the Suburbs. Yes, I am joking. DWGTBBT ends up being a musical episode without even really intending to, but I mean, it has at least 3 songs, and it's not longer than a normal television episode like the Christmas movie is. This is what I like to call a Wizard of Oz musical. The protagonist meets a new person, that person sings, they meet a new person, they sing, and so on and so forth. The inverse is what I like to call a Willy Wonka musical, where when somebody sings, somebody from the group is going to die. And somewhere in the middle of this graph is Charlie the Unicorn. Dad forgets his wife's anniversary, so it's up to the kids to work together to reform the band Love Handle. When I first saw this, I didn't know what it meant, as it was the concert where their parents shared their first kiss. The team needs to go find each band member, convince them to join the reunion, and set up the concert all before their mom gets home. A common opinion shared by the fanbase is that the episodes where Doofenshmirtz and Perry work together instead of fighting are a lot more sweet and fun to watch, and we do get a little bit of that in this episode, but I always like the episodes where Candace and the boys work together, especially for someone who isn't that close to his older sister. They also happen way more rarely, so it's just nice to see. I know some nitpicks I had with Clone High's musical episode were that it doesn't feature the main characters singing enough, and that there's a lot of stories happening concurrently, making it seem unfocused. And you can use the same arguments for this episode. This episode also has the trippy background as well.
So what's this?
This is psychedelia. It's where the guitar solo came from.
No, I mean, what's with all the colors? I have no idea.
I guess it comes with the territory. With this episode, I actually don't mind it as much. The characters in the show sing all the time, so having the new characters each get a song about themselves actually works a lot better with their episode. Not that Phineas doesn't sing in all the songs, because he does. The cast is full of singers. They have Ashley Tisdale, Mitchell Musso. Yeah, I was rewatching a bunch of So Random episodes last year. Don't ask, I was going through a thing. And some musical guests are like Justin Bieber and Selena Gomez, and then some are Mitchell Musso. Disney really wanted this guy to be an artist. I will never forgive him for abandoning Pair of Kings for this. What was I talking about? There are three plots in this episode, and while they aren't created equal, it's a 22-minute episode compared to the normal Phineas and Ferb 11, so I think it's fine. There's not a lot the group could be doing in between each song anyway, so they might as well just cut away from it. The Perry B plot isn't that interesting, but I'm pretty sure it's the first appearance of Vanessa, the best character, so I guess it gets a pass. The C plot has one good bit, but it also happens to be my favorite bit in the episode. You snuck your way right into
my heart. That's my ma.
Oh yeah.
There's so many well-written jokes in this episode, like very witty. You could tell someone had multiple rewrites, but they don't hold a candle to That's My Ma. Every single one of these songs is a banger. Not so much the song that's supposed to be a generic love song, but for that reason it gets a pass because that's kind of the point. Nobody asked, but my ranking is Snuck Your Way Into My Heart, because again, it's supposed to be generic 80s love song. That doesn't make it not the worst in the episode, but it's still good. Danny's Story. The song is a lot of fun because of how fast it transitions from different music era to different music era, but because of that, it never really has enough time to pick up momentum. It's more of a plot device, which in a musical isn't technically a bad thing. Fabulous. This one gets number two for being both catchy and funny. Ain't Got Rhythm, because it's the best song in this episode and possibly in the series. I chose this episode all because of this song. It had such a profound impact on me that when I started watching this episode for the first time in like a decade to prepare for this, I still remembered all the lyrics. Also, I can't go into a library without thinking about this song, so that's gotta count for something. I don't go into libraries that often.
So what do you say? Are you back in the band?
Well, maybe if I can find my old leather.
Dude, we're getting the band back together.
Hey, that's the name of the show.
Welcome back to the annual Musical Episode Awards.
Boring.
For our next award.
That wasn't Christmas.
Look, I'm okay with you doing your own dumb bits in the corner over there, but now you're stepping on my feet. I'm trying to host a show here.
A Christmas award show without a Christmas episode.
I'm working up to it.
Talk about something you hate. That always gets views.
I've done that too much already, saying, ooh, this thing is shit. Who let this happen? It's boring now.
Like the Super Mario Bros. Super Show?
What's your point?
We need hate. It gets clicks.
Well, I want to remain positive here.
How about we split the difference?
There's no way to split the difference between hate and love. I need to present two awards for best musical episode from a bad show and worst musical episode from a good show. Oh, I guess that would do it. No matter what, I'm still being positive, I guess.
Do the bad show first.
I want a Lexus all in pink and a dad who doesn't drink.
Oh, and that reminds me, 12 kegs of beer.
All these happy wishes and lots of Christmas cheer is all I really want this year.
Let's get this out of the way first. Road to the North Pole is not the best musical episode of Family Guy. Far from it. But all the other good musical episodes take place in the first couple seasons. I like to separate these two as they're like entirely different shows. The first couple seasons is a good show. Everything else is a bad show. If it takes place in season 9, it's from a bad show. That's what makes it all the more shocking that there's a good episode in the dump pile.
If you put a Christmas tree in the public airport, I will go to court and sue your ass.
Alright, well, it's still got some of those, Family Guy-isms. People blame the fall of Family Guy on Seth MacFarlane, and while it's true he's kind of responsible, it's not for the reason you'd think. It didn't get bad because he just made it bad, it got bad because he stopped caring. He phones it in, and can you blame him? Family Guy doesn't look like it's going anywhere, and he clearly doesn't want to work there anymore. He tried to kill this thing, but it won't die. One thing he is passionate about, though, is his music. So when it comes to these musical episodes, he goes full send. He's actually put a lot of musical references in the series, one of which got cut because... Oh! hey, look, guys, we got our telephone hour reference. Am I going to get in trouble for this? It's also worth noting that the co-creator of Phineas and Ferb used to work on Family Guy and actually worked on some of those music sequences, so it had to come from somewhere. I say this with no mockery or hint of irony. I think Seth MacFarlane should make a musical. If the South Park guys can do it, then I mean, why not? I mean, South Park is leagues better than Family Guy, but just do it anyway. It's also a good Christmas episode, and a show that doesn't really have a lot of Christmas episodes. I could talk about the next Christmas episode in season 12, where—
Brian, look out! What the hell?
You know what? Never mind. I suppose I should actually talk about the episode. But why? I see the same take on Twitter every couple months saying something along the lines of, "You don't know anything about animation if you call this show lazy. All animation is hard and takes a lot of time." And while that is true, Family Guy is lazy. Okay, maybe it's just bad fund distribution, but you get what I mean. Regardless of whose fault it is, there is not a lot of time going into it. Do you know how much one episode of Family Guy costs? $2 million. So then why do the characters only have four static poses with stretched out jokes and recycled backgrounds? The fucking Mario episode had more animation than this. Family Guy has a huge budget and it very rarely goes towards anything. That's why I think this episode stands out way more. It's got beautiful backgrounds, and even aside from the musical songs, has amazing instrumentals for the action-ish scenes. This episode just encapsulates this cozy feeling of Christmas, which makes it even more of a shame that it isn't that funny.
Yeah, we're trying to get to the North Pole. I don't suppose you're from AAA, are you?
Ooh?
AAA, you know? AAA.
Oh, AAA. Hey, I just came from AA.
No, not AA, AAA.
Yeah, that's what I said, AAA.
Oh, so you are with AAA.
Oh, no, that's AAA. I just came from AAA.
This is only half of the bit. It keeps going. I'm gonna speed through it. And it's still not gonna be done. New Family Guy is famously ugly, mean-spirited, and unfunny. So this episode only really being unfunny, plus having good music, gives it a pass for me. The bar is pretty low. The Road 2 episodes are always held up as the best in the series, and this one has more similarities with the older seasons as far as cutaways go. Another fault of modern Family Guy is putting like 50 cutaway jokes in an episode. There's only like 3 or 4 cutaway jokes for this, and for a double length modern Family Guy episode, that's pretty good. And the couple they do have actually aren't that bad.
Hey Lois, would you make an appointment for me to be neutered in 2 days?
Are you sure, Brian?
Yes, I'm sure. And whatever I say in 2 days, do not let me convince you that I've changed my mind.
Wow, you sound pretty serious about this, Brian.
Oh, I am.
This would have been really funny, but it also keeps going on and on and on. Can I talk about something that kind of bugs me, though? As I get older, I find myself liking dumb juvenile jokes way more than, like, vulgarity. Seeing John Cena spray paint JBL is poopy on a car is way better to me than DX saying Vince likes cock. When you can say anything, you don't really have to come up with creative insults or weird lines. The uncensored version of the opening song goes like this.
Doesn't this seem like too much stuff?
Suck my dick, it's not enough.
Suck my dick. It's effective, but not really that funny. The censored TV version, however.
Doesn't this seem like too much stuff?
Poo on you, it's not enough.
Poo on you is not only something completely different, it also fits a little better with the character. I will never really advocate of censorship of someone's art, but more often than not, limitations are what make something better. There's this one line in the Arrested Development pilot that goes like this.
This is the magic trick, huh?
Illusion, Michael. Trick is something a whore does for money.
Or candy.
The joke has a couple layers. Job is pressured to clean up his line around children, but he chooses to change the final line to candy, meaning that the line is still, a trick is something a whore does for candy. That's the joke. In the uncensored original version, it goes like this.
This is the magic trick, huh?
Illusion, Michael. Trick is something a whore does for money.
Or cocaine.
I feel like this somehow misses the entire point of the joke that they didn't even know they were making. Alright, we're going way off track here. Sorry about the artistic integrity of, poopy. I wouldn't recommend watching this episode, but I would recommend listening to the soundtrack. But be careful because—
Each little elf used to fill up a shelf, making playthings and selflessly thrilling us. Now they're on crack and it feels like Iraq, because Christmas time is telling us.
There's still some Family Guy knee slappers in there. Oh boy.
That's for true.
That wasn't nearly as hateful as I had hoped.
You asked for a good episode.
Do the other one.
Whatever. We're already off schedule anyway because of the Arrested Development thing. Let's do the worst episode from the best show.
Yes! Now that's an adventure.
We should go soon.
We can go anywhere in a balloon.
Yes!
That's an adventure.
We can go high.
We can see anything up in the sky.
Yes!
Community is one of the greatest shows ever made. Except season 4 isn't very good, and season 6 feels pretty off, and season 5 loses a lot of characters, and actually season 1 has some skippable episodes on the beginning. It's hard to describe why this episode doesn't work without talking about Community at length. So that's what we're going to do. See, 2021 does have a through line. Community is famous for doing concept episodes. The school is engaging in a paintball war, action movie. The group finds some old memories, fake clip show episode. Pierce needs to play through a classic video game to get his father's inheritance before his half-brother gets to it first. Maybe I should have started with something simpler. Season 4 is regarded as the worst in the series and just all around not very good. There's a lot of reasons as to why, but I feel like the most noticeable one is that the concepts really come from nowhere. Like, you get the feeling the gimmick came first and they tried to write an episode around it. Season 5 has a fantastic episode set in a G.I. Joe parody animation, and the episode is themed around the fact that Jeff is upset that he's getting old and his refusal to accept that fact, so he retreats into childhood nostalgia. Season 4 has heroic backstories in the form of a comic book, flashbacks. They retcon a lot of stuff. I do not like this episode. A puppet episode that probably took an insane amount of man hours and money to put together. They go in a hot air balloon because they're awkward around each other and then end up in the woods and do drugs and they don't move after that. Like, you aren't really utilizing the medium to its fullest potential, and I should know, I love puppets. The theme of putting all these episodes together was supposed to be Christmas, but almost every episode we've talked about so far has some kind of psychedelic scene in it. Is this what people think musicals are? Because they're not entirely wrong. Bad writing is one thing, and normally overpowers everything else, but Community utilizes a lot of improv, so it's not all bad. The season is carried by the actors. This episode is carried by the actors.
There is a fire in the cafeteria!
Yeah, not now!
I love that line. I never really watched this episode aside from just listening to the songs because the songs are good. They have nothing to do with anything and add some character details I pretend aren't canon, but they're catchy, I guess. That Jeff becoming a surrogate dad thing and then bailing bugs me so much and it's never brought up again. Jeff definitely gets the worst end of the stick in the season and they do stuff that's important to his character and now can't be undone or redone. The songs sound fine, if not, you know, good, but everything else sounds really weird.
This one's for global cooling.
And this one's for the amount of rubber wasted while making stupid bracelets.
That's called rubber flubbing, and it's a real problem. Open your eyes, people!
Britta said open your eyes, people. Square.
Nice.
Like, this episode was made ages before COVID, but it sounds like everyone recorded their lines on their phones at home in a closet. And it's really off-putting and even weirder that they have done voiceover work for the show multiple times before this. This episode in particular is just sound mixed really poorly. Let's, for the sake of comparison, talk about the actual Christmas musical episodes that I would rather talk about. The Christmas episodes all correlate to the season they take place in. Season 1 is the most grounded, but still very solid. Season 2 gets a little more high concept. The third goes full throttle into cartoony. And the fourth one is bad. Abed's Uncontrollable Christmas is not only a high concept stop motion episode that actually uses its medium to its full potential, but also has a purpose for existing. That purpose is equal parts heartfelt and heartbreaking. And bonus points, it doesn't sound like it was recorded in a sewer. Look at this train action set piece. Look at these sets. Really, Pierce's model was put in the chair because his character was in one at the time. When the cast becomes different toys, they all have distinct walk cycles. Troy and Abed do their cute little handshake. It's so meticulous. Not only is the acting very good, but the singing is also very good. This is an Abed-centric episode, and those tend to get incredibly high concept because he's the most emotionally complex of the cast. So he's doing most of the singing as he sings off each character that leaves the adventure. Oh, this is a Willy Wonka musical. I like the chart.
A journey through Winter Wonderland tends to test your commitment to Christmas. So when I say test, I mean Wonka style.
Oh my god. The only thing the puppet episode has over this is how it utilizes Donald Glover, a beautiful singer. He's in this episode way more, but he doesn't really get that much spotlight. It is an Abed episode, but still, you got Donald Glover. In the puppet episode, however, he gets the best part.
I call
was the Greendale Buyer of 03. 55 acres went up in a blaze, all because I burned an ant hill.
I was gonna say watch the episode just for that part, but you can listen to the song on YouTube. That's what I do. But it makes sense because this episode is all about Abed. His mother watched Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer with him every year. But this year, she has a new family, she's moved on, and Abed can't handle it. There's a concept episode in season 5 where the whole theming is set in a place because it's not a game to Abed. All the cartoony high concept things are actually happening to him. It's his brain. It's a defense mechanism. The Christmas stop-motion style makes sense, and it's heartbreaking. It's not fucking, hey, superheroes are popular right now. Oh, and also, Jeff caused Shirley's divorce. I hate this shit. But Abed has a new family, too. I always feel the strong emotions when Pierce, in particular, comes back. These two barely share any time together in the entire series, and when they do, it's normally very nasty. But that's not why he came back. Eventually, all his friends come back. They all sing together to help their friend, because they all feel the same way. It would have been so easy to have things go back to normal after this, but the concept stays. They commit to it. They even commit to it when they flash back to this episode later. The only shot of human them we see is the reflection of the TV. That ending scene where all the friends, all with different messy families, come together to spend Christmas with each other. This is family, not who you're related to, but who you feel welcome around. They are a family. They are a community. That's gonna be hard to top.
Glee, it's a feeling you get when your brain finally lets your heart get in its pants. Glee, it's like a drug that you use that turns pain into shoes and your shoes into dance.
How's your piano still playing this song?
The season 3 episode is not a better episode, but it's more of an overt musical parody, and it's my favorite because of how much it indulges in that fact. There's an ongoing one where the community from Community makes fun of the Glee Club from Glee. Not very subtle, but funny nonetheless. Community's homages get chalked up to parody a lot of the time, and while parody can be made out of love for a thing, I think people get the wrong vibe from the show. When the show has a Western-themed episode, it's not because they hate Westerns, it's a loving homage. A lesser show would have just gone, you're breaking into song out of nowhere? That's dumb. Musicals are gay, and again, not wrong. But while the episode does shoot some jabs at Glee, the show, the musical aspect is made out of love for the genre.
Is what I'll spread to my friends, like a virus that sends them to a healthier place. Glee, I'll understand every scene, because they'll sing what they mean instead of making a face.
This is also an Abed-centric episode where he wants to bring joy to his friends after they've had a very dark year. Something that is actually consistently hinted at throughout the entire season. It's an Abed episode, but everyone more or less does get something dedicated to them. It's like a Wizard of Oz musical. They're slowly converted to the Glee Club, each with different songs, and I actually didn't notice this at first, but you can tell who's converted because they start wearing sweater vests from that point forward. And even though the music is very important to the plot, they still got some improv in there as well.
How could that
happen?
Butter
and AIDS and Twin Peaks!
No, fake butter, AIDS, and Twin Peaks.
That was Donald. The original lyrics were, it was more benign than that.
It was like Back to the Future 2 and Jaws 2.
Yeah. So I was like, I was just doing an intentionally bad rhyme, like rhyming two with two, but then Donald came in the studio and I was like, I think we can beat this, and he came up with, was it fake butter and AIDS?
Yeah.
And Twin Peaks.
Abed, Troy, Pierce, Jeff, and Shirley all get songs themed around their conversion.
Happy birthday. Oops, yeah. I can't sing. Yeah, if it's ours.
You can.
No, Danny, you haven't been here. We're not allowed to sing anything. If it's a real song, if you make it up, if it's on the show, you can't sing anything.
And Tristram,
I was a little bummed the song got cut short. I kind of hurt my little feelings.
And that's you look because at, you she looked at the video show as being from, something that services
Invasion
you.
Of the Body Snatchers.
But no, it's a 20-minute story,
yeah,
and it wouldn't have been funny.
7-minute songs, and I had 30 seconds. I think it could have been
as
more
hilarious as finishing that song would have been. As hysterically funny.
I did say more or less. The show has had such a profound impact on me. I wonder if it'll start impacting my speech like other stuff does.
It hurts my little head when I'm lying in my bed with visions of sugar plum socks.
Is this a bit?
Oh, yeah. But we do get a Britta song at the end, kind of, and then get one of, I think, my favorite lines of the season, if not the entire show.
Mr. Renison, I think it's fine. Now, Greendale is an all-inclusive school. Why don't we let Britta sing her awkward song? Yeah!
They save themselves by sticking up for each other, and then the episode ends with them all sitting around the TV watching Christmas specials together. I live for this shit. I may have gone a little off the rails there.
I thought you were supposed to talk about one episode.
It required more context. Plus, the other ones were Christmassy. That's what you asked for.
All these videos end up way too long. At least there isn't any other show with three musical episodes. No.
You gotta stop teeing me up for these.
I got a producer to talk to.
Can't hear you. I'm too busy presenting the award for a show that has done both diegetic and non-diegetic musical episodes. This one could take a while. This video already is way too niche of a topic and includes way too many confusing lines to understand. So while we're here, I might as well try and teach something. There are two types of musicals. There's probably more than two, but for the sake of this argument, there's two. The musical that gets parodied most of the time is characters breaking into song at random moments and singing songs out of nowhere. This is non-diegetic music. Music, because of suspension of disbelief, we know isn't actually playing. When Dear Evan Hansen starts singing painfully about his dead classmate to his grieving family, we know he isn't actually singing here. We hear it as a song, but in the universe of the film, they're just hearing him be an evil monster. And this doesn't just apply to musicals. In movies like Suicide Squad, we know that the cast isn't actually listening to Super Freak, it's just playing in the background. I wish I thought of a better example. Alternatively, you have diegetic music. In the opening scenes of Guardians of the Galaxy and Spider-Verse, we hear popular songs as the background music, but the protagonist can also hear them. Diegetic is when it exists within the universe of the film or musical. They are both actually listening to the songs playing. Or like that one scene from Twin Peaks where Audrey turns on the jukebox and it plays the show's background music, and I think the people can hear it. It's actually pretty unclear. This is a bad example. In musical form, it's something like High School Musical. When Troy is singing about basketballs with his ball mates, we know this isn't actually happening. But something like Bop to the Top is actually being performed in-universe. The characters can all hear this. There's other movies like Scott Pilgrim and Baby Driver and a third Edgar Wright film, probably. So when it comes to musical episodes, it normally goes one of two ways. It could either feature the cast putting on some kind of show in-universe, or some kind of magic overtaking them and making them break into song and dance numbers. What's really cool is that there's not many shows that have done both, but even cooler, one of my favorite shows has.
You gotta pay the troll toll. If you wanna get into that boy's hole, you gotta pay the troll toll to get in. You want the baby boy's hole, you gotta pay the troll toll. You gotta pay the troll toll to get in.
I said before that it's no real coincidence that most of my favorite shows have musical episodes. You have to be a special kind of lame to make something like this. The kind of lame that I absolutely love. Always Sunny's first musical, a diegetic one, The Nightman Cometh. Most musical episodes reference popular musicals to show their love and appreciation, and while that's well and good, what makes this episode great is that it's more about the production of a musical, and it's pretty accurate.
Dennis, what are you doing?
I'm eating because I'm very uncomfortable.
Well, you guys are making... Can you just get on the stage, please? And can we finish this rehearsal?
What are the odds that they did an episode about putting on a musical and putting on a wrestling show? This show is made specifically for me and no one else. I could talk about the episode and how great it is, but you've heard it all before. What I would rather talk about is the fact that they actually rewrote the episode to be a 50-minute long live stage musical and then actually performed it. There is no other show more after my own heart. I have this theory that Always Sunny's fanbase is made up of one half actual nerds who care about musicals and differing film styles and unique genre flips, and then one half people from actual Philadelphia also love drinking and find the characters cool and edgy. So because the show is set in a bar, they decided to have the live show in a bar. So by the time they start the show, everyone is already pretty drunk. I don't know if you've ever seen a live show where the audience is full of drunk people who are only really there because they think the show is funny and don't care much for musicals. I don't know any situation where that could have happened to you, but it doesn't go well. There's a lot of people screaming and heckling and a weird amount of dissonance of the show. In the show, everyone hates these guys. And in the live show, which everyone came to see the live version of a show they love, so of course, everyone loves them. Which is fine, you know, I can't expect people to boo them. But also, the cast of the show is always shown as undesirable, but constantly wanting to be desired. So when in a song where the character who no one is attracted to bends over, and then a bunch of drunk fans in the audience start touching his ass and balls, and it's at its worst when it comes to Dee. Dee's bit in this episode is that she wants all the males in the audience to think she's hot, but is struggling because the one song she gets makes her sound like a child molester. In the show, she comes out on stage and asks any interested men if they want her number, and no one cares. In the live show,
most men find me to be an 8 or 9 out of 10.
You feel as if you are in a lot of danger. But yeah, regardless, this episode is fantastic, and the fact that they even decided to make it into a real musical shows a deep love of the genre. And while most of the main cast members are here for it, it's all equally parts their show. One orchestrated it. One musical boy named Charlie Day. Believe it or not, Always Sunny is actually a very musical show, and I have no doubt in my mind that that's because of Charlie's input. He has written all of the songs, not even just in the musical episodes. My favorite song is the spider one.
He just won't let go. He's laying around. He's got a mean bite. Now he's ready to fight.
I wasn't joking. He's incredibly talented. Another episode he wrote all the music for was The Gang Turns Black. This is the non-diegetic episode. And while the gang can hear the music, we know that no one else around them is really experiencing it the same way anyway. The Nightman Cometh is a classic. It's incredibly quotable and most people's favorite episode. But honestly, for me, the best musical episode in the series goes to this one. Always Sunny isn't just a hilarious show. It also uses its terrible characters to make political commentary and tackle important issues. And I know that may have scared some of you off because of experiences with political commentary in shows like 13 Reasons Why and CW shows like Riverdale. Knock it off! But the show, more often than not, has a point to make. And this episode is no different.
They like me. They gave me this train.
He's got a gun!
It's commentary in the form of a musical episode with fantastic songs and allusions to The Wizard of Oz, and also references to a show I've seen and refused to find and watch. Also, my god, another knockout performance from this rat boy.
Now it's just some guy that banged my mother. Like this guy and the other.
I think I might like dudes. That's enough of sucking Charlie's dick. Why don't we suck another character's dick? Like Dee. If we're going by the rules we set up, that to count as a musical episode, it must have at least three songs and be a normal TV length, then technically Always Sunny has three musical episodes. Did I do this just because I rewatched all of Always Sunny and I want to make the most of it? Or did I do it because I want to put it on the same podium as Community? The answer is yes to both of those. Frank's Little Beauties technically counts as a musical episode, and while it's not my favorite musical episode, it's still one of my favorite Always Sunny episodes. See, it's got songs in it.
Write a song about how we do not diddle kids. Do not diddle kids, it's no good diddling kids.
There is no quicker way for people to think that you are diddling kids than by writing a song about it.
Before you get mad in the comments that this song doesn't count, I did not count this song either. It's a joke. I'm always partial to Dee episodes, as she always gets more deranged and is a very spiteful and bitter character. People always say Dennis is morally the worst character, but at least he has some boundaries. Dee will really do anything to get what she wants. And while the dudes get a funny B-plot, the main star is Dee. Dee wants to stick it to the pretty girls in this beauty contest that remind her of her mother, who hates her. So she picks a random girl to take under her wing and basically forces her to live out her childhood dream.
They're nothing but a big humongous pain in the butt, a big humongous pain in my vagina. Moms are ugly.
The episode ends with the chaperone turning out to be a kid liker and gets taken away. Everyone decides the pretty girl wins, and they never talk about this again. I love this episode. Well, that sure was an entire lesson put into what was just supposed to be a single episode review. What do you think? Oh, it's just him. I know people are upset about the idea of Chris Pratt playing Mario, and that makes sense, but the idea of a potential musical movie starring both Jack Black and Charlie Day, that sounds fantastic to me.
I'm Seth MacFarlane, creator of the television series Family Guy.
Oh, Seth MacFarlane! Did you get my letters?
I'm Seth MacFarlane.
All right, you got it, dude. Time to talk about Seth MacFarlane again. I'll be presenting the award for American Dad is Good, Actually. These transitions are getting pretty weak.
Around the world, it's all the same. Children freeze when they hear my name. Crappers, please don't beat me so. But do I listen? Sadly, no. 80% of kids end up turning into dirtbags. I just laugh.
American Dad often gets lumped in with its sibling shows, but it isn't nearly as obnoxious as Family Guy or as unfunny as The Cleveland Show. A show I've never actually seen. At least I don't think I have. This whole video was a ploy to get you here so I could convince you all that American Dad is way better. The first couple of seasons are better than the first of Family Guy, and as Family Guy gets worse, American Dad also kinda gets worse, but it still isn't bad. Like, proportional, it's still good. It does, however, copy some of the worst parts of New Family Guy occasionally. New Family Guy tries its best to shock and disgust you, while American Dad doesn't do it as often. They definitely go to the incest joke pool way more. Family Guy has absurd gags with grounded plots.
You're pregnant with our baby?
Semi-grounded plots. American Dad is way more absurd and sticks to it. Like in the episode we're about to talk about, Krampus kidnaps Steve and he lives in a castle with Beauty and the Beast talking furniture, and it's not just a throwaway gag, it's part of the plot. You see absurd as shit in Family Guy and you're like, oh boy, time to spin the wheel to see if a joke will be funny. You see it in American Dad and say, oh, I hope these new characters survive this episode, I really like them. Spoiler alert. They do not. Did I mention American Dad also does action better? If you're a fan of American Dad, I hope there's some of you out there, you're probably confused as to why I chose the Krampus episode, as it's not the best musical episode in the show. But if you're a fan of this video you're currently watching, you know that we gotta hit our Christmas quota. I went into this video thinking Community and Always Sunny had the most musical episodes at 3, but American Dad has way more than that. Anyone else tired of the singing on American Dad? Hey, where do you think you are, bro? And yeah, before you ask, the best musical episode of the series is the one with the killer hot tub voiced by CeeLo Green. Did I mention the show is actually good? They sing all the time because of how well the entire voice cast can actually sing. Regardless of episode quality, the show always seems fun regardless. Maybe the reason it's more well-liked than Family Guy is because the family doesn't fucking despise each other and one of the characters isn't relegated to gross punching bag. I don't know when this started, but the show has a running gag where whenever nerdy white kid Steve sings, it's a powerful, soulful R&B song. And because this is a Steve-centric story, most of the songs follow suit. So if you're not into that genre, there's this one.
Family, say it 1, 2, 3. Family is the way for me. Oh yeah, do it for the family. We gonna make them happy. Oh Lord.
You know what? Bad example. The worst part of this episode is that it doesn't use the Good Morning USA theme. That's gonna dock it some points. It's Christmas time in wherever they live. Steve is misbehaving and all around being just very spoiled. Stan says that he didn't turn out like that because his father was always hard on him. This gives him an idea. So he goes to prison to see his dad, where his dad tells the Smith men about the legend of Krampus. I also gotta say, we're in season 9 at this point, so it makes sense that they're trying new plots, but I don't think I've ever seen a Christmas episode of anything themed around Krampus. I don't think I've seen a normal episode of anything themed around Krampus.
I released Krampus. I just wanted him to scare Steve straight.
Sexual orientation is not a choice!
What?
Did I mention that this episode is really funny?
Santa's village is behind this wall. Give me a boost. Take my hand!
Absurdity really is the way to my heart. See, this is what I mean. Talking furniture type beat.
Oh God,
I'm dying.
I probably should have spread these jokes out, but it helps make my point more if they're all like this together. Give the show a chance, man. Stan releases Krampus from the pot his dad locked him in years ago to punish Steve for him. Krampus kidnaps Steve and only promises to return him if Stan brings him his dad. The two stories split. Steve and Krampus have a soulful musical adventure, and Stan and Roger have an action-packed trip to the North Pole. Fun for the whole family. Not only does the show feature absurd creations that are all very much canon, but it has way more continuity than you would think. All episodes are canon unless explicitly said otherwise. In a previous Christmas episode, Stan went to war against Santa, and in this special, not only does Santa remember it, but it's a very important plot point. No, 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 you can't just watch American Dad when it airs. You must watch it all in order, or else you're gonna get spoiled on the plot. You watch American Dad dubbed and not subbed. The reason so many of these episodes are animated, even the sitcom ones, is because animation lends itself well to musical numbers. And while this episode doesn't feature psychedelic epilepsy colors, it does use its medium during song. Look at this animation. Can I stop with the begging now? Will you watch the show, please? I don't work for them, but I sure would like to. An action scene you saw already happens. Santa kills Krampus, Steve's dad takes a bullet and kills Santa. They reconcile with the fact that taking Krampus away from the world was wrong, and now all kids are terrible. They both die, their blood mixes, Stan's dad becomes the new Krampus, and because this is American Dad, this is an important plot point later. Wow, what a fantastic Christmas musical episode. And this ain't even the best one. It's like 8th or something. Even the subplots are surprisingly wholesome. However, there is, one issue, though. American Dad started out as a satire. In the early seasons, Stan is written as a straw man who learns from new lessons every episode. One episode is about guns, one episode is about racism, one is about masturbation, you get the deal. As the series goes on, it leans less on political commentary and more on absurdity, both of which I like, but separately. So it's very rare that a moral episode shows up in the later seasons. It's hard to decipher which episodes are big shitposts and which are actually supposed to be lessons. It's like when Donkey says a good game is bad as a bit and then continues to argue about why it's bad. Like, wait, does he actually not like the game? I bring it up because this episode's lesson is that kids become spoiled when parents don't care enough to punish them. I'm cool with that. What I'm not cool with is the implication that the way to make kids behave is to physically beat them. Like, yeah, careless parents lead to rotten kids. The solution, of course, is to smack your kids with a bamboo shoot. I know it seems kind of cringe to get offended at a Seth MacFarlane cartoon, but I honestly can't tell if they're memeing or not. Everything else is played for laughs, but the beating kids thing doesn't really seem like a joke. Maybe I'm bad at detecting satire, I don't know. If that is the moral, it's a very strange one and kind of poisons the episode. But if it's not, then it's a really funny episode with good music and I just got baited really hard, I guess. See, that was fun, wasn't it, Seth?
I'm Seth MacFarlane.
Seth, where'd you get that? Okay, calm down. I've already talked about two of your shows. You can calm down.
I'm Seth MacFarlane.
Now I just need to not upset him. It's time to present the award for musical episode from the best show featuring a lovable family with yellow skin. Oh no. This is not good. Oh, it's the farming one.
I'll hand out free candy, bestow loads of cocoa. You'll wonder out loud how could I sleep so low. It's a simple fact, a secret I'll spill. If I can't have Christmas, nobody will.
There's a lot of kids cartoons where the main kid character is just kind of a nice kid. Like, I get that you want them to be marketable and relatable, but the reason I think I like Big City Greens so much is that Cricket is a little bastard man, little rat boy.
What? The naughty list? Oh, come on. What'd I do that was so bad? Oh, right.
He actually did do all of those things. So Cricket has been a bastard boy the whole season, and now he's at risk of being on the naughty list and not getting the presents he wants so bad. He believes the meaning of Christmas is about getting free stuff and is spoiled because of it. And the episode resolves it by him learning the error of his ways and not by getting beat with a paddle. I gotta move on, but it still really bothers me. Tilly, his sister, on the other hand, is the embodiment of good, but gets herself into trouble with her naivete.
But I'd rather spend my time doing nice things for folks, like that man over there.
Oh, I don't think a little guy like me can handle all this by myself. It's Slippy.
She sees that there is good in Cricket, so she helps him do good deeds to help his global standing on the list, but he's not very good at it. While we're at the mall, I should say that the only bad thing in this episode is the severe lack of Gloria, the best character in the entire show. Once the mall Santa tells Cricket he'll be on the naughty list for sure, he doubles down. This episode starts out with a jolly opening where the cast is kind of sing-talking, except for Grandma, who's singing her goddamn heart out.
The worst part of Christmas are those three stupid ghosts who come clanging in the night to bang on your bedpost.
It's all fine and good, though, because it sets the scene and does really get you into the mood of Christmas. It's also pretty funny.
When we all gather round and trim the living room tree, and the dining table tree, and the bedroom tree, and the basement tree,
and the secret tree,
and the bathroom tree.
Seriously,
too.
Seriously, Dad?
And this year we're all together, cause your mom is back.
Eggnog doesn't always have to be alcoholic, but I feel like in this specific scene, it is. You think that this is going to be a fun Christmas jaunt with songs kind of thrown in, but once Cricket goes full bastard, it goes full throttle. I know that an episode impacted me if I listened to the songs in my free time. I haven't listened to the Clone High song since I watched that episode, but ever since I watched this episode like a year ago, I've listened to this song almost every day. That is not a joke. I just really like villain songs, and Cricket knocks it out of the park. It had an effect on me. I wonder if it'll start impacting my speech like Community did.
Jeez, kid! Did you do all of this?
Do any of us really do anything?
Oh, yeah. The third act is where it's at. Cricket sings the bastard song and destroys the big city tree, but unfortunately, it gets blamed on Tilly.
Channel 11 News reporting from the collapsed corpse of our city's beloved Christmas tree. How does it feel to ruin Christmas?
Ruined Christmas?
There you have it, folks, a confession.
Not only is the episode funny, it's also heartbreaking. Tilly sings a lament about her current standing and how she feels about Christmas, and this line,
I guess this was my fault, thinking there was hope for you, but now I see clearly that was never true.
God, that never stops hurting to hear. I can feel the heartbreak. See, this is why I said lovable family. Community and Always Sunny are my favorites because of this found family dynamic. They all have shitty home lives and they all kind of find solace in each other because of that. And that's why it speaks to me. But I can still see the value of a good related family in shows like this. I mean, look at Arrested Development.
Speech! 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 Speech!
The family continued to chant, speech, 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 for no one in particular.
Why did I rewatch all of Arrested Development for this video? Answer, I didn't watch it for this video. I have no control over my life. I got the worst fucking attorneys. It's nice to see the family care so much for each other, especially Cricket and Tilly. It'd be really easy to make these two, like Ben and Gwen, hate each other for no reason, but they don't. They're completely different people, but they're siblings who have both been through a lot. They don't agree with each other, but they want to be in each other's lives. They love each other. Wow, if you excuse me, I should probably go make some calls. We'll be right back.
It's when we wish each other Merry Christmas, one and all.
Merry Christmas!
Welcome back to the annual Musical Episode Awards. I guess this is annual.
I am back.
Is there something you want?
By decree of a higher power, you must halt with your side tangents and happy good feelings and continue with the episodes we agreed upon.
We agreed upon ranking musical episodes of TV. I did not agree to sharing the stage with a new skeleton. What happened to the old one?
You're in for it now. I have handpicked the next category and winner.
And if I refuse and do this the way I want to? All right, I get it. What award?
It's on the floor in front of you.
And now the award for, you have to talk about Buffy again. What's Buffy?
Crawl out of your grave, you find this fight just doesn't mean a thing.
She ain't got that swing.
Thanks for noticing.
She does pretty well with fiends from hell, but lately we can tell that she's just going through the motions.
Okay, so I lied a little bit earlier. I said to fully understand the context of the musical, you need to watch the whole series at least up until that point. I watched like 2 seasons of Buffy and then gave up. This episode is in the middle of season 6. I already rewatched so many shows for this. I even rewatched a show I didn't have. Could I let this one pass? What could I have possibly missed in a couple of seasons? Let's just start the episode.
Previously, I love you.
Here lies the warrior of the people. Let her cross over!
But I think I was in heaven. I was torn out of there.
We're getting married.
Congratulations. Willow, you are using too much magic. Can we not do this now? Shh, forget it ever happened.
All right, so I missed everything. If we're ranking these episodes by how good they are on their own, Then we have kind of an issue here. Most musical episodes are fun side stories that mess with the medium to tell a fun story. This episode takes place in the middle of a bunch of drama, and if you try and watch it on your own, then you will be very lost, like I was. On the same end, if you're a Buffy diehard, I can't imagine this episode is how you would want to see these plots played out. So who is this for? Joss Whedon, that's who.
Which is ridiculous, because witches, they were persecuted, wicked good, and love the earth and women power, and I'll be over here.
Gee, thanks, Joss. A lot of directors have their quirks that you notice when you watch a lot of their films. The Russo brothers like their snappy dialogue. Edgar Wright likes to incorporate music. Christopher Nolan likes to assault your ears. You don't really notice the warning signs until after the fact, but I always notice that both Joss Whedon Avengers and Joss Whedon Justice League have a scene where a guy lands on top of a girl with his face and her big bazongas. You know, weird stuff. From what I watched of Buffy, it seemed normal. I just don't remember it being this, how do I say that, incredibly horny?
Into the tide, I can feel you inside.
I'm all for gay witches, you know, I love gay witches in shows, but this seems like a weird thing to put in this musical episode.
Warm in the night when I'm right in her tight embrace, tight embrace.
All right, man. I get it, it's like cum. It's cum, dude. You know, like cum, man.
You're the cutest of the Scoobies, with your lips as red as rubies, and your firm yet supple, tight embrace.
Knock it off!
So that's all. You just come to pump me for information.
What else would I want to pump you for? I really just said that, didn't I?
They all do it. It's all of them. Stop!
They don't even know its name yet, but Willow will find out. She's a brand new type.
Alright, that one's kind of clever. These aren't clips I took throughout the series. These are all from this episode. I heard so many people say they were kids when they watched Buffy and that it was their first experience with violence, but this part never came up. Oh, I said came, didn't I? If I had to describe this episode in one word, it would be uncomfortable. Yeah, that's the perfect summation. Not just because the sex is icky, but just in general. I told you this was a drama-filled episode. It's a drama show. Everyone is pissed at each other for a different reason. No one is happy in this. I don't want to watch miserable people talk about boobies and eat each other out through song.
Yes, the 15-year-old can spend half an hour alone in her locked house.
Back we will go to my kingdom below, and you will be my queen.
Never stops being uncomfortable, by the way. Oh no, I can't believe this demon isn't a good person. Oh, but it's okay. The conflict is resolved when it's discovered that Xander summoned the demon, and the demon does not want to marry him because he's a dude.
Ew, I may be a pedophile, but at least I'm not gay.
I don't know, man. The choreography is good. The effects are good.
I was the only one there, but your power shone.
Why do I bother saying anything? He's a little fucking guy. I don't like this one. This one was not fun at all. Also, it's not a big deal, and I don't mean to age shame anyone, but the series started when they were in high school, and I don't know where they are in season 6, but none of them are passing anymore. Like, why are all these 35-year-olds still doing this? I skipped a lot of seasons, so it's just, I guess, weird to see them from looking young to immediately looking old. Kind of like Arrested Development. Aw, oh, come on, that one was a joke.
Well, then jokes are banned too.
Why do you want this video to be bad?
You're the only one making it bad. People like negativity.
But I like musicals.
Well, too bad, because this is my show now, and I make the rules.
Seth, you came back!
Hold him off and finish the ceremony. Control.
Thanks, Dad.
What?
Sorry, I meant Seth.
But you didn't say Seth.
I know, I misspoke.
This is weird.
Yeah, I should probably just move on. And present the award for... It just says Rebecca Sugar.
Gunter, why did you gunt my fries? I gunted them, and they were mine. What kind of gunt gunts is Gunter's fries? And doesn't even gunt him in the eyes. Gunter, there were tears there. If you gunted them, would you even care?
This is probably the best one to end with because everything I talked about previously comes back into this. Remember when I said I count Family Guy as two shows and you got really mad and said, that doesn't make sense, it's one show. Well, Adventure Time is three shows. I always talk about them as Pendleton Ward's Adventure Time, Rebecca Sugar's Adventure Time, and Adam Mudo's Adventure Time. I know Rebecca Sugar never ran the show, but you can You know what, that era, you can tell. When Adventure Time first premiered, I was hooked immediately. At that time, when it first aired, it was a show I found hilarious, with a fun episodic story where anything could happen. Sure, there were theories that this stuff at the beginning of the theme song meant some kind of nuclear war happened, but it was just a spooky fan theory. There are tons of those. It's not like the Ed Boys are actually in purgatory, it's just all preteen fun. I always liked Adventure Time. It's not like it was a bad show that got good, it was a good show that got fantastic. Seasons 1 or 2, were fun, and most of the episodes are still classics to this day, but around season 3, we started to see some changes. Pendleton Ward didn't officially step down as showrunner until season 5, but you could tell by the episodes he's credited on that he gave up way before that, which is fine. I'm cool with that. Season 3, episode 3, we see a glimpse of Marceline's past, but it's still a little fun one-off episode. Look at the dancing baby! Season 3, episode 10, the first musical episode of Adventure Time, but not the one we're talking about. Hey look, it was written by Rebecca Sugar. Hey wait, did these two know each other? Why does she wear the shirt as pajamas? Season 3, episode 19, the day the show broke me. I loved Adventure Time, it was like my favorite show, but I didn't think it was capable of making me emotional or intrigued. I was very wrong. This crazy cartoon villain we've been watching for multiple seasons used to be a normal man named Simon Petrikov before his ice crown turned him into the man he is today, but he has no recollection of it. This is what got me onto those Adventure Time forums. The theories weren't just cartoon conspiracies anymore. There was lore, there was mystery, and it was important. Season 4, episode 25. I remember you. I thought it could make me emotional. I didn't think it could make me cry. Why am I talking about this episode and not What Was Missing? It's because a good musical episode isn't just an episode with some good songs. A good musical episode is a good episode, a great episode, a fantastic episode. It stands on its own. Unlike Buffy. And if you're upset that I didn't choose the one hinting at bubbling because you want queer representation, then guess what?
We can be a prog rock duo. I'll even split the fans with you. I get the princesses and you get whatever it is you're into.
Thanks, Rebecca. I know it was you all along. I know the show was definitely in the process of changing, but if previously it was slowly peeling off the band-aid, then this episode ripped it straight off. Putting myself in the shoes of when I first saw this, Marceline and Ice King had never interacted before. People use the theme song as evidence that they've been planning the story from the beginning, but I don't really buy that. The first couple of seasons don't really care about backstory. If all the humans are supposed to be gone, then what are these business dudes? It's not only an emotional episode with only fantastic songs somehow fit into 11 minutes, but we also get a lot of information.
Look! This clipping, this was you, Simon, before the war.
I know we take it for granted now, but again, imagine you're seeing this for the first time. A war has not been mentioned up until this point. This is the first mention of the big war and that Simon and Marcy knew each other. The episode immediately following this pushes this into high gear. After this episode, Adventure Time was not the same show. It was better, somehow. The show where the weird deer with the human fingers kidnaps people by licking them is the same show where an orphan refugee struggles to make her surrogate father remember her to no avail. It's tragic, and it's happy. They spend time together, and they both enjoy it. They miss it, but it's not the same. Cozy would be the word. I also chose this one because it's kind of related to a Christmas episode, because it has the same Simon plot, but, you know, I just chose it because I like it. I watched this when I was 11 years old. I didn't really know what it was meant to represent, but I knew it was sad. Because after last season, Simon became my favorite character. I cared about what happened to him. Is Guardians of Sunshine hilarious? Yeah, but it didn't make me cry. And it didn't have enough songs to meet the quota, sorry. This truly is one of, if not the greatest musical episode of television. And it's not even close. Wow, that was powerful. Or at least I hope it was, because otherwise you guys are gonna think I'm weird.
You are weird.
What did you do with Seth, you freak?
No, no, no. You don't get to make me play along with your dumb running bits. We're gonna make this video into the thing it was always supposed to be.
No, you don't mean.
That's right. A top 10 list.
No! What's up, gamers? Welcome to ScrewAttack's Top 10 Dual Barrel Roll Hottest Samus Metroid Moments. I don't like this format. Fine, if I have to rank the ones I've seen to an objective best, then so be it. And the rule of one episode per show does apply. Number 10, Road to the North Pole, Family Guy. It's a pretty episode with some decent jokes and fantastic music, but it falters due to the fact that it's a late season Family Guy episode and Bryant doesn't get hit by a car in this one. Number 9, Raising the Stakes, Clone High. Clone High is a much better show than a lot of the ones higher up on this list, but unfortunately that doesn't make this episode a good musical episode. I said that a good musical episode isn't just good songs, but also a good episode in its own right. This kind of has the opposite problem though, because it's a good episode with very underutilized musicality. Number 8. Feel Me, See Me, Know Me, The Powerpuff Girls. This episode has the opposite problem, where all the songs are good enough for me to listen to them in my free time, but that's a pretty low bar. But the episode isn't that great. It would be lower, but the episode doesn't feature any dialogue that isn't in song form, so the good songs is actually the entirety of the episode. Number 7, Dude, We're Getting the Band Back Together, Phineas and Ferb. This episode gets a little more over because it is both a good musical episode and a good episode. It also has Veronica. Olivia Olsen is getting a lot of love in this list. Number 6, Minstrel Krampus, American Dad. I wish I could put this higher to make a point about the show, but sadly that's not how the list works. Let it be known that number 6 doesn't mean it's bad. I think all of the episodes on this list are good, just some are more gooder than others. Number 5, The Gang Turns Black, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. This is where the list starts to become more controversial. I think this episode is a better musical episode than The Nightman Cometh, but not a better episode. I had to compromise. If it makes you feel better, it would have had the same spot on the list either way. Stan Charlie Day, I love him. Number 4, Green Christmas, Big City Greens. Hey, Always Sunny fans, this is the thing I thought you'd be mad about. Is Big City Greens a better show than Always Sunny? No. Does it have a better musical episode that is both funny and heartfelt? Yes. Sorry, but not really. Number 3, Abed's Uncontrollable Christmas, Community. I compromised on this one the other way. I had to give up on my own feelings here. I think Regional Holiday Music is a more fun musical episode, but I could not in good conscience say it was a better episode. The top 3 were really hard to separate. This episode is still fantastic, and not just good for a musical episode, but one of the best episodes of TV ever. Number 2, I Remember You, Adventure Time. I feel like I gushed about this a lot not too long ago, so I'll keep it brief. This episode marks an important turning point in the Adventure Time series. This is the point where the show gets more emotional, important, mysterious, creative. I ran out of things to call it. It's good. It's a good show, and this is its best episode. Sue me. And finally, number 1. Not too many years ago, I tried to hold down my love of things, specifically shows, so I could seem more credible because they were objectively bad shows. I was worried about seeming cringe for talking about a cringe show, but I don't care anymore. I may be cringe, but I am free. The greatest musical episode of all time is
Both of Me and I Love Both of You. Both love me and I love both of you.
Steven Universe has its problems, but I think the main issue I have is that it barely utilizes my favorite characters. Mr. Greg is, get this, a Greg episode, and he's the best part of the show. Without giving too much away about the series, there's this girl that both Pearl and Greg are in love with. The girl marries Greg, and then dies to have their kid, Steven. I see a lot of people decry that the show gets brownie points it doesn't deserve for not being as deep as people think, but like, this is a pretty complex situation. This may also be the episode that makes people think the show is just singing and crying, because there is a lot of singing and crying. I never really understood why that was an insult though. Maybe the crying, but like, what, you don't like music? Why? I really love musical numbers in cartoons. Could you tell by the, you know, the whole list? But I can't really articulate why. I don't know enough about music, but I do know a decent amount about musicals. And it's clear that the people behind the show also know probably more than I do. It is Rebecca Sugar's show, after all. She kind of sweeped the top of the list. Ah, breaking the fourth wall. I've been working on this list for a long time, and I wrote it before the Amphibia episode came out, the musical episode that is Christmas episode, and Rebecca Sugar was on it. It would have been cool to talk about it. It would have made a lot of sense. Maybe next time. This is the only episode to feature a proper reprise, The songs and melodies come back later and have a deeper meaning. We have come a long way since Super Mario Bros. Super Show. Each song manages to be both good and different. There's a lot of good musical episodes with good songs, but a lot of them follow one theme and kind of sound samey. And yeah, there's crying, but I think this time is justified. I don't actually think there's a bit of crying in the show that isn't, unless it's for like a gag, but it's still in character. I feel like I've been more defending this show than actually talking about the episode, but the episode exemplifies what's great about the show. Even if you don't like the show, you might probably still love this episode. We get fun backstory and deep character studies and good music and emotional moments. Did I mention good music?
You won and she chose you. And she loved you and she's gone.
Aw, man, this show is just singing and crying. Yeah, dude, have you heard the singing? For whatever reason, this show in particular has a very dedicated hate fandom to it. A lot of people that like the show think it's just because they're homophobic, but honestly, I think it has more to do with hating popular thing. And blaming this show for making all cartoons serialized and CalArts looking when there are still good episodic shows. They just don't watch them. Great, now every show is like Steven Universe. Where are the old cartoons? What's Clarence? I'm not watching that. What's Jellystone? I'm not watching. Stop recommending me stuff. I refuse to be proven wrong. And honestly, if you want to blame a show for making all modern cartoons serialized, then it's honestly more Gravity Falls' fault. Good luck fucking complaining about Gravity Falls, bitch. Again, more defending than the actual episode, but the episode is just fantastic. This has been building up for a long time. I didn't actually think I'd ever be talking about this show again, but I'm glad I did. I'm glad I came back to it. I love cartoons, I love musical episodes, and this is by far the best one. For now.
Beats and the sounds and the buildings towering, subways that run from Brooklyn to the Bowery, Empire City!
And let's bring Pearl.
That didn't sound very objective, that sounded angry.
Yes, fine, maybe I got a little angry. Are we done here?
Not quite yet.
Oh, you're gonna do another thing? Do you know how long this is already?
I promise this will be the final thing.
It better be worth it.
Trust me, it is. Why don't you take a look in your pocket?
The award for most likely to make Andrew very mad. Oh, please. What could possibly make me?
We were so tiny, happy and shiny, playing tag and getting chased.
I like looking hot, buying stuff they cannot. I like drinking hard, Max and Dad's credit card. Dad says, act your age.
You heard the boss, it's time to rage.
Let the beast turn out the lights.
This is the Thunderdome. But I won't.
Happy holidays, everyone.
We'll be right back.